That really hit the spot. There's nothing quite like an ice-cold drink of water to quench your thirst. But where does that thirst come from? Well, I get thirsty because I'm dehydrated, right? But it's not just me that's dehydrated. I'm made of trillions of cells that all work together to keep me healthy, and they get dehydrated as well. Oftentimes, because cells are so small and collaborative by nature, it's easy to forget that these little guys have needs, just like you and I do, just on a much smaller scale. So, how do individual cells get what they need, like food and water? I mean, it's not like a hungry cell can just swing through the nearest buffet and load up a plate. Well, grab your lab coats, because in today's lesson, we'll explore this and more as we define cellular transport, explain the difference between active and passive transport, and describe how cells use these processes to maintain a little something called homeostasis. Let's get into it. When we're dehydrated, our brain sends us a not-so-subtle signal that says, drink something. And then when we do, that signal goes away. It's like when you're told to clean your room. If you ignore the signal, it's only going to come back stronger than before, potentially much stronger and scarier than before, but if you take care of it, the signal stops. Your body sends you these kinds of signals all the time, like when you're hungry, hot, cold, tired, or remotely uncomfortable for any reason. This is because at any given moment, our bodies strive for something called homeostasis, which is a state of balance among all the body systems needed for the body to survive and function correctly. For example, thirst is just your brain's way of telling you that there is a water imbalance in your body, so you can fix it and maintain your own personal homeostasis. And remember, we are made of trillions of cells that all factor into this balancing act, so this is no small task. It's actually pretty incredible that our bodies can manage it at all. So how do they do it? Well, one of the most important tools your body has to keep all of your cells happy, and consequently keep your tissues, organs, and organ systems happy as well, is something called cellular transport. Cellular transport is the movement of substances across a semi-permeable cell membrane. Remember, a cell membrane is a protective barrier that wraps around cells and helps control what moves in and out. Semi-permeable means only some things can get through the barrier. Each of our cells needs to maintain a certain balance of materials, so cellular transport is the exchange system that allows cells to obtain what they need and get rid of what they don't. There are two main types of transport that your body uses to achieve this. The first one we'll discuss is called passive transport, which is the movement of substances across the cell membrane without spending energy. There are three methods of passive transport we will discuss today, and they are called diffusion, osmosis, and facilitated diffusion. Diffusion is the movement of molecules from an area of higher concentration to an area of lower concentration. Simply put, molecules want to go from where there are more molecules to where there are less molecules. You can think of this as individual molecules disliking crowds and preferring to spread out if they can. Diffusion is happening everywhere, all the time. For example, let's say I have company coming over and I want to freshen my place up. I spritz a little air freshener here, a little there. When I spray the air freshener, there is initially a high concentration where I've sprayed. However, over time, the molecules will naturally spread out to where there are less air freshener molecules. They'll do this until they are distributed evenly across the entire space. When molecules diffuse naturally from a high concentration to a low concentration, we say they are moving with the concentration gradient. You can think of this as moving along a river with the current. You don't have to spend any energy to get where you're going, because the river does it for you. So, how does this relate to keeping cells healthy? Well, let's say one of your cells is in desperate need of some oxygen. If the cell needs it, there probably isn't a lot of it in the cell. In other words, the concentration of oxygen in the cell is low. However, let's say there is a high concentration of oxygen outside of the cell. In this case, oxygen will naturally diffuse into the cell exactly where we want it to go without having to spend any energy. It's a free delivery system, and who doesn't like free deliveries? Diffusion works best with freely moving particles suspended in a solution. A solution is a mixture in which the molecules of one substance are evenly distributed within another substance. Kool-Aid, mouthwash, and even the air we breathe are all common examples of solutions. Our bodies also happen to contain solutions, like the blood in our veins and the cytoplasm in our cells. And, believe it or not, the makeup of these solutions determines how water moves around in our bodies. Which brings us to our next topic and second form of passive transport we'll be discussing in this lesson, osmosis. Osmosis is the movement of water molecules from a solution with a higher concentration of water to a solution with a lower concentration of water across a semi-permeable membrane. Now, you might be asking yourself, wait, isn't that just diffusion of water? What's the difference? Well, whereas diffusion can occur anywhere, osmosis only occurs across a semi-permeable membrane. To illustrate the difference between diffusion and osmosis, let's consider an amoeba swimming around in a petri dish of purified water. An amoeba is a single-celled organism that has a semi-permeable cell membrane, just like the cells in our bodies. The amoeba's cytoplasm has a higher concentration of things like salt and sugar than the purified water around it. However, diffusion says some of these substances will move with a concentration gradient, escaping out into the water. Luckily for the amoeba, salt and sugar molecules are too large to fit through the semi-permeable membrane, so the amoeba gets to keep those. However, if materials like salt and sugar can't leave the amoeba, osmosis dictates that water will move into the amoeba, flowing freely through the cell membrane to water down the amount of salt and sugar in the cell. This is nature's attempt to balance the water concentration inside the amoeba with the water concentration outside of it. As you can tell, both nature and the amoeba have very different ideas of what balance looks like. But I digress. The big takeaway from this story is that if a material can't diffuse and create balance because of a semi-permeable membrane, water will move across the membrane instead, from a high concentration of water to a low concentration of water. Of course, osmosis can be very helpful for life forms as well. For instance, when we are dehydrated and drink water, the water moves in our bodies from a higher concentration outside of our cells to a lower concentration inside of our cells, providing life-giving support exactly where it is needed with no energy required. Hence, why osmosis is considered a form of passive transport. Now, with all this talk about semi-permeable membranes only letting some things through, you're probably wondering, what if a cell needs something that doesn't fit through the cell membrane? What then? Enter facilitated diffusion, which is the passive movement of molecules across a cell membrane from a higher concentration to a lower concentration with the help of a transport molecule. An example of this is glucose, commonly referred to as sugar. Glucose is too large to pass through the cell membrane on its own. It can only enter your cells through a special channel when the transport molecule insulin is present. Insulin binds to receptors on the cell's surface, causing special proteins to allow the glucose to enter the cell. It's like glucose is trying to get into a house with a locked door, and insulin is the key. Facilitated diffusion is super useful because it gives the cell more control over what goes in and out of its cell membrane. All right. So far, we've learned that diffusion, osmosis, and facilitated diffusion are all types of passive transport that don't require energy. But this isn't the only way materials move through our cells. Materials can also move through a form of transport called active transport. Active transport is the movement of substances across a cell membrane against the concentration gradient, which requires energy. If passive transport is traveling with the current of a river, then active transport is traveling against the current. There are lots of different times when active transport occurs in cells. Let's say a cell needs all the potassium it can get, but the concentration of potassium inside the cell is already greater than the concentration of potassium outside the cell. How do we get that pesky potassium to go where we want it to go? Basically, the cell now has to spend energy to transport the potassium, exchanging sodium for the potassium as part of this process. In fact, this particular exchange is a type of active transport called the sodium-potassium pump. There are several different kinds of active transport like this that occur in our cells, but the important thing they all have in common is that they exist to help us out when the concentration gradient is not on our side. Phew! Alright, we have now covered the basics of cellular transport. We learned that our bodies are constantly trying to maintain homeostasis, or balance, in order to stay healthy. One of the main ways our body achieves this is through cellular transport. Passive transport, which includes diffusion, osmosis, and facilitated diffusion, works with the concentration gradient and does not require energy. Active transport travels against the concentration gradient and does require energy. And that's it! Until next time, fellow biologists, I'm Caroline, and remember, life is full of wonders, so keep learning and don't ever stop wondering.